So we have had a understanding of the power scenario globally and changing trends and scenario in the country. And from there, we have emphasized the need for high voltage laboratories for test purposes. And we have had a look at the generation of these test voltages in the lab. And we have also had a look at in the lab yesterday. And remind you about the thing that whenever we say I have applied so much voltage, I need a measure of that. So measurements are important, and in fact we are taught measurements even at the second year undergraduate level. But there are some issues when it comes to high voltage measurements and high current measurements. High currents can lead to high thermal temperature rises. High voltages can lead to possibility of allowing high currents to flow through you, so safety hazards are there. And resolutions, and there one common thing which we use is dividers. The moment you assume a divider, you assume that there is a certain ratio. Is that ratio valid all through? That is the basic thing. And some of these things are important, especially in the changing scenario, because when we even test voltages, types of voltages, waveforms, all are getting changed. So change is the way of life. Things keep changing, they don't remain static. That's very, very important. So we will try to do and enable you to take away something which is not really very well known, but how to apply the known concepts in the changing scenarios. That is what is the scope this afternoon. And another thing which I wanted to tell you is, we also would like to see if there are any things that need to be discussed. We could do that also in this session. This session will be followed by a laboratory session where, as we said in the morning, one will be impulse voltage generation will be seen physically. We saw only DC and some low voltage AC as applied to electro spinning yesterday. So we will see high voltage AC and impulse this afternoon. So now I hand over the class to Professor Jayaram.
I'm sorry, you're getting bored of my voice in the morning, afternoon, but will not take more than 1 hour.
Yeah. Yeah, but I have a very way of saying, we have registered for the course, so we have agreed to listen to one person. This course is meant by, to be offered by only one person with one host.
That's why you should ask more questions, then we can get young voices.
The available voltmeters or your oscilloscope may not able to measure at the most more than 1 kilovolt. Right? But we already know from the generation side what we have discussed in terms of AC close to 2 million volts we needed for today's power system of 1000 kV operating level voltages and potential for 1.2 MV level. And impulse is almost close to 6 million volts. So now we have to find a way how to measure that. So that's what we are looking at, what kind of transducers we can use here to bring those voltage levels so the meters can tell us the measured values. Some of the references here. We are quite familiar now with spark gap. Okay? And they are one of the measurement components we can say used in high voltage engineering. Just some slides, I'll go quickly. This is again to emphasize that we are discussing measuring voltages in test labs or research facilities or maybe manufacturing places, not measuring voltages or current in power grid. Okay. But just to be aware what's happening in a power system or a power station, this is one of the single line diagrams. I think you have done power system courses, right? Single line diagram for 132 kV bus. That's one of the bus here, one, and bus two, 132 kV. So good schematic here representing a potential transformer, breaker, a current transformer, a lightning arrestor, because there's an expensive transformer here, lightning arrestor on the other side of the transformer too. And once again repeating the same, a CT and a potential T here. Conventionally, CTs are used for current transformers or PTs for potential transformers. Now they use the term voltage transformer instead of potential transformer, because today's potential transformer or the instrumentation transformers are not necessarily based on electromagnetic principle. They could be electrostatic or capacitive dividers. Okay, so this is actually a photograph of a similar, not exactly the same grid you saw in the single line diagram, a substation where you can see whole bunch of, I think it may be a bit clearer, a whole bunch of instrumentation transformers here all along the line, and a whole bunch of instrumentation transformer for current measurement, and obviously switches here to interrupt any problem. So this is a station. You have the conductor or the bus bar connected to the bus, and maybe the line further away. So that's your RMS value of the current flowing at system voltages. And that means at that level, you are already at the, if it is 132 kV means that's always line to line. So whatever the equivalent of line to ground is the potential at this point. So every line is monitored here, it has to be. So you have to measure voltages, currents on a real time basis. And that's what the control room will be monitoring. So why is it important to monitor or record these values? First of all, you want to make sure the system is in stable condition. Are there any abnormalities happening, right? By measuring voltages and current, they can calculate the load, they can calculate the power factor, they can also understand the are there any over currents, are there any over voltages, or even the voltages dipping. If there is a fault, the potential may collapse. So for this system, stability point of view and the load flow, how much load is flowing, how much power is flowing where, these two measurements are a must. So they have to monitor every second. The control room will be monitoring those values. So because this is, assuming this is our grid of 132 kV, now we can't measure 132 kV in the control room. It may be a few hundreds of volts. So you need a transducer here. That's where we use potential transformers or voltage transformer. Same thing with the current. So the current passing here will be much, much higher, hundreds of amps. So, but what you can read in the meter is very small. So that has to be stepped down and sent to the control room. So that's one thing. So there's another important role for these instrumentation transformers, or monitoring the voltages and currents here. What do you think they are necessary for? Yes, thank you. So for protection purpose also, you have to constantly watch what is happening. If there is a change in the current, that's when the relay senses already. You know, today's digital control or digital protection system, they don't even wait until the fault happens. They're almost predicting what may happen, and that's what they use to increase the speed of operation of the relays and also the breaker. So that's why we need, so from the monitoring the power flow, monitoring the stability of the system and the protection, and then another important role too. If anyone can get? Yeah. So we monitor, power flow is going good, no stability issues good, relays are all given the instructions good, but there's another one, economic side, they have to charge the companies. So for the metering purpose, these measurements are important. Right? Otherwise, who do charge, how much this electricity board will charge that utility or another big industrial load. So for the metering purpose. So protection, metering, load flow studies, and stability, I think they are together. That's how the actual measurements are done. Right? But when it comes, this is another close-up view, SF6 field circuit, CT or the current transformer. This is an oil filled current transformer, which means this structure here is a hollow structure. This is also a hollow structure. Internal to that, you have to fill with some kind of fluid. That's an insulation internal. Because what you are measuring the current passing here is at your high potential. what goes out of here is at a very low potential, maybe 200 volts or even 100 volts. So you are now you have to bring that high current to this level. So internal insulation is essential. So that those are the structures. As I said, quickly we'll go. So this is the old type of potential transformers where electromagnetic principle like your conventional transformers were used. But now we are trying to get away from them using capacitively coupled potential transformers. Now these transformers are now, this is a power transformer. These transformers definitely are the backbone of any power system. If a single transformer of this size, several hundred MVA fails, that's going to lead to very big catastrophic condition. So an expensive unit like this, see how many monitoring systems are there. In this particular transformer almost, every phase you have a potential transformer here, a potential transformer here, another potential transformer here. So the voltage of every phase of the transformer is constantly monitored. This transformer, one potential transformer is used, although they may be obtaining the other two based on the phase angle. A transformer of this large size, the both sides, the high voltage here, maybe relatively high voltage here, they both are at a significantly high voltage. If you have a line, 500 kV line, and it is connected to 132 kV sub-transmission line, so the transformer is still working on high voltage on both sides. They have to monitor those also. But when it comes to measurement, we are discussing for testing and other application purpose, we're not going to use any of those instrumentation. Right? The main reason behind that, the measurement we are going to do are much more accurate compared to the CT or the potential transformer you are using for voltage measurement compared to a potential divider you are going to use here. The accuracy is more important here because what you are measuring in a grid, as I said, philosophy behind these measurements are we have to monitor the voltages and correct for the understanding that voltages are stable, there's no big dip, stable, right? And monitoring, relaying and protection. But if you are going to make some measurement that is used to declare the life of this CT or life of this voltage transformer or life of this big power transformer, our measurements have to be much more accurate. Because based on the measurement, we are going to say, okay, the dielectric strength of this insulation used in this transformer is good enough now. Or if you are testing a line insulator, repeatedly you may make the measurement and say, okay, this is good enough now. So that's where it differs. We are not using a potential transformer or a current transformer. Although if you are using some current transformer in some measurement, they are much more accurate. Sometimes you need a high frequency response current transformer. So otherwise, the main difference between there and here, the instrumentation is a little bit different. Okay. Instead of using potential transformer, we'll be using potential dividers. And spark gaps are a good instruments to use. I'll explain in a brief few minutes, briefly how they are useful or accurate also the measurement. There's not much big difference between these two. A high impedance in series with an ammeter, you multiply the current reading with the impedance, or you can use two resistors or two capacitors are a mixed R and C for potential division. Electrostatic voltmeters are the only voltmeters. They say absolute value can be detected, but they are very, very rarely used. Not all labs have electrostatic voltmeter. Same with electrostatic field meter. But depending on the time, today we have 1 hour, I'll just show you how non-contact type electrostatic voltmeter can be used for making the measurement on the surface. Without touching, you can non-contact type, you can still measure very accurately the potential on the surface. And that, those are very useful in applications like Zerar. Nowadays nobody uses the film for everything is digital camera, even like the films. Or in textile industry, where they have to handle a lot of polymer and quite a bit of static charge. So they, in order to know what's the potential, because it can lead to dangerous electrostatic hazards. So that's where they come handy. We have talked about this, so let's skip quickly. We know how the breakdown occurs. And this breakdown here is a function of two parameters, the gap distance and the pressure. And you can talk about other geometries, you know, like a rod-to-rod gap or uniform field gap. Almost all of them are not standardized to be this one. Best one is to you go for a spherical electrode. I mean, everywhere people like to cut on the material used. Why make a big sphere if you can half the sphere can do the job? So that's how the shape has been taken. So, okay, now you have two hemispherical surfaces with a gap distance of, let's say, S as given here. So as long as you keep that gap distance, where in that region, because that's where the spark is happening, the electric field can be defined as uniform electric field, more or less here you can see. Then you can use that for measurement we are going to do. So some people use different shapes, solid electrode. Some people use, higher the voltage you go, the sphere size gets very bigger and bigger, and they also have a hollow sphere as opposed to a solid sphere. And that's just to show that the electric field in the region of interest is pretty uniform here. Okay. So if you were to use as opposed to sphere gap, a parallel plane, then the edge effect is still an issue where the curve bends at the very end, unless you contour that to eliminate. They become more expensive compared to sphere gap. So that overall here we agree that spherical electrodes are kind of in course, will give you homogeneous field in the region where the spark is occurring. So we can assume that they are uniform electric field. Having made that assumption, now all the charts available can be applied here. So what we are going to do, many different electrodes, spherical electrode like this. We have one of those in your lab too. So differences is because of, morning you are asking what are that big circle donuts I call them, maybe you can call them wada if you want. So now this is also another electrode design made to be very spherical. The idea of putting small pieces of electrode material and making the spherical structure here is to make it lightweight and the cost, instead of having a big solid. Okay, so but this one, you remember that if the gap breaks, that means it's a disruptive breakdown here. So the gap, it has to break here. Just real quick. So you for a given gap, it will break down. No matter how many times you apply the voltage, the insulation like air in the open, most of the spherical electrode they're all open to atmosphere here, or room. So that no matter how many times you repeatedly apply, with a small time space given, consistency of this breakdown here until almost you start wearing off the electrode is within plus or minus 3%. So measuring 1,000 kilovolts with that accuracy, that tells you that the physics behind breakdown of spherical electrode gas breakdown is pretty consistent. Right? Of course, there are parameters that can influence here. The room pressure, room temperature, or we call it as air density factor and temperature. Right? Because Paschen is the one who first found that if the gas pressure and the distance are varied, or PDS on x-axis, pressure times distance, and breakdown strength on the y-axis, and we found that unique characteristic, I think, is. So this is your PD here, this is the breakdown voltage here. So more on the vacuum side, high pressure side, there is a minimum. You found that curve. Consistently, you can observe this. So you know that the breakdown depends on pressure. So depending on the magnitude of the voltage you have in your mind, you can set up the gap. So only just because this breakdown happens every time you make a measurement, the breakdown has to occur here. Breakdown, what we call in high voltage engineering term, and power system engineer's term, it's a short circuit. Every time the gap breaks means there's a short circuit. So imagine that the test transformer doing all the taking up all this number of times breakdown. That's where the design of test transformer differ from power transformer. A real power transformer sitting in the grid probably will not see more than 10 big short circuit on itself within its lifetime, a very large one. That, well, they are protected already. But test transformer sitting in your test lab, each time if you study, well, now we have this undergraduate student using our lab, sometime up to 60 of them, four in a group. Everybody loves this arc. Okay, keep on breaking. So in a one given term, the transformer is subjected to maybe 500 times the short circuit, right? So that's where the big difference comes in terms of designing the insulation of your test transformers. Okay, there are some things, factors that influence other. If the surface is not very smooth, if you have a rough surface, that can be a potential for the field enhancement initiating the spark. Because everything depends on, as I was telling this morning, first availability of an electron, and that electron gaining the energy in the applied electric field, colliding with another gas molecule, releasing a new electron, depending on the probability, of course, every collision may not give rise to new electron. Eventually, so many large number of electrons form an avalanche, leading to space charge, and then the streamer growing into a breakdown. But everything happens so quickly. Okay? So that's when the surface has to be clean and smooth, and free from other grease and other things. The curvature is important. Gap dimensions are also very important. Alignment, of course, if you're not aligned properly, it would give rise to a problem. That's where, again, spear gaps are handy. Putting two spears quite closely, you have the curvature, as opposed to putting two electrodes parallel plane. The alignment may be top electrode is slightly bent like this, or top electrode may be bent like this. That gives rise to a different gap. But two spears is much easier to get the gap consistently the same. You can mount them horizontal or you can mount them vertical. There are advantages and disadvantages of both. These are more preferred because this structure can be part of your ceiling and only the bottom portion can be moved. If you have a horizontal one, it takes up a lot more space in your lab. You can use it for AC, DC and impulse measurement. But you can only measure the peak. Again, remember that the breakdown depends on the peak value. It's all physics. It doesn't know RMS value. It doesn't know your nothing. It is the peak value. It depends on the peak value. And there are standard measurements that are done at standard temperature and standard pressure. Tables are available. We have to apply the correction for air density and humidity. But for a uniform electrode geometry, even considering the sphere as well in the same category, humidity effect can be ignored. So the air density means pressure and temperature. The tables are there. Very fast rise time pulses are a little bit harder to get good accuracy. So this is all about, you'll find in Kofelberg, how much clearances should be there, otherwise the field gets influenced. And these are the tables. What the table shows here, for a gap spacing of 25 millimeter gap spacing, different voltages are spheres of different diameter, 6.25 centimeter, 12.5 or 25, and that's where 69.5, 72.5 or 72.5. More consistency is there. Okay. So, and 30, you have 79, 85 and 86. The gap is a bit more here. So now you have to decide what should be the gap distance for each measurement you have to do. For that, you have to have this chart available. So I'm assuming that we have to measure 132 kV is our target, then we can see where approximately where we are in the range. So we'll try to space 55 as the gap distance. Looking at this, this is not very accurate. Between the two, you can choose one. So to be more accurate, you choose the larger diameter. Okay. So because the recommended value, the gap distance should not exceed the radius of your sphere, or half the diameter. Okay. So like that you can use it, and for the larger numbers. So once you have the measurement made, so So let's say you are what you are doing, you have a test setup. You can put a test object, but if you want to only looking at the measurement, we have set the gap. So you can vary the potential of this transformer, regulator and everything until the breakdown happens. When the breakdown happens, that transformer will have a circuit breaker, it trips. Then all you have to know is what the dimension you have used here and what is the gap distance you set it for that particular measuring value, the D value. And today, that day is temperature and pressure you monitor. Okay, once you get the temperature and pressure value, you can calculate the air density factor using this empirical formula, where P0 and T0 are the standard conditions. Correction factor, there is another table available between the two. More or less, they're very close to each other. Now, the voltage to be measured, what is the voltage you want to know? And D0 is the voltage reading from the set gap. So we know the dimension, diameter, we know the gap distance at which it broke down. And then you're going to go to the table, find that value, and use that value, use the correction factor to get the actual value. Okay? So that's how the measurements are made. So again, as I said, delta to correction factor, they are much closer, so you can as well calculate the delta value. Okay, so that, I think one point we missed here. So that's how you measure AC and DC. Okay? So easy for AC and DC. But it doesn't mean that when you are looking at the breakdown part, there is 3% accuracy. Right? AC, DC, you're taking maybe three readings, average of 3 data. Now when it comes to impulse measurement, so now you have to, not the test transformer, you have the impulse transformer now, impulse generator. And we know that this waveform has a very short time, and then you are using spherical electrode for the measurement. The breakdown here as a probability, even under AC. Now you have a very, very short pulse, like 1.2 microsecond here. And you have to see that when the breakdown occurs. So for that purpose, the way the measurements are done for impulse, what we call it as a 50% flashover. Okay? Flashover means like this is a flashover here, or even the breakdown of your gap. So what is this under the impulse, what you are doing for impulse measurement? There are few statistical methods you can use. Simplest one for the class teaching purpose, 50% probability of the gap disruption is used. Okay. So you have no idea when it is going to break down. Okay. So you set the gap and then keep increasing the voltage. No breakdown. Or you will also have a test object here to compare also. Increase the voltage again, there is no breakdown. Increase the voltage further, no breakdown. Eventually, the dark circle here shows there was a breakdown. So identify that part. So you may have started at 10 kV, 11 kV, 11.5 kV, or whatever, 12 kV here. Okay. So once you hit that breakdown, that means now you have to reduce the voltage applied by delta V, and there's a breakdown again, which means you have to further reduce the voltage you apply. There's no breakdown. Then keep increasing until there is a breakdown. If there is a breakdown, reduce it. No breakdown, increase it. Likewise, you repeat this. Depending on who you are doing the test for, if it is to be done on a transformer of expensive device, probably they'll ask much more detailed analysis of the statistics and larger number of the values. Otherwise, you can count 10 values from here, 10 more values, and in that 10 values you're taking after the first breakdown, if 50% of the time you find a breakdown, you can declare that as your 50% flashover. Instead, if you get all 10 of them breakdown, I know it's absolutely breakdown, maybe you are applying too high a voltage, so you have to reduce the voltage. But with this up and down method, once you hit the breakdown, reduce all the way up to no breakdown, and go up until the breakdown, come back, go up. So finish 10 readings or 20 readings. So in that, it has to be 50%. But there are a lot more complex statistics used. Okay. So that's how the spear gaps are used. So simple, you connect the gap across the measurement you want to use it. One, knowing the dimension, values from the table, you can know the value of exactly what was the value at that time when the test was done. Are they going to use the spear gap today? Are they going to? Oh, okay, they'll see that. Okay, so there's one missing point with the spear gap measurement. If you are, especially if you are measuring an impulse, it doesn't tell you anything about the wave shape. Okay? And we said earlier this morning, we said it can be a full wave, it can be a chopped wave. When you are applying these impulses, we don't know whether the breakdown occurred here, whether the breakdown occurred here, or breakdown may have occurred during the rise time itself. So you don't get to see that. Okay? So there's absolutely no information on the wave shape of what you're measuring. It only gives you the peak value. Okay? And same with the AC, same with the DC as well. So if you really want to know about where the breakdown occurred, did I apply a right impulse, for all of that you need to monitor or record the voltages as well. Okay? So that's where potential dividers are used, where you get more information than just the peak value. So in terms of the theory of using the potential dividers, it's not any big change than the very first time we made the measurement in first year electric circuit class. Put two resistors, and you know the potential. If the current is the same, then if you have two resistors, potential division is known. So you can calculate the voltage across this in terms of the total voltage you apply. So that same formula still applies. So the two impedances here can be resistance to resistance, capacitance to capacitance, or mix of R and C. There's a reason behind each, which one is better for which application. But then, what's the big deal about these potential dividers? This is a resistive divider. Okay? So if I'm just putting two resistors in series, why we have to look at such a complex device, and probably will end up having to pay for a 500 kV potential divider a lot of money on this, maybe 10 lakhs or even a lot more than that, $50,000 to $60,000 or even hundreds of $1,000s, depending on the voltage. So that question can be answered here one by a little bit. If you're looking at this example, I keep seeing a flashover occurs here. I can find a resistance for you. So, okay, resistive divider means so there's R1 here and R2 here. Okay. So, in order to divide the potential, maybe I want 10 mega ohm here, or here I want 250 ohms. I'm just taking the number. A 10 mega ohm resistor, I can find a 10 mega ohm resistor which is only as this height, or maybe this height. Okay. So I can definitely have two ratio, very big ratio here, to give me the ratio of voltage across, maybe measured here on an oscilloscope, not exceeding 400 volts. But the problem is this physical dimensions we have to worry. Okay, so if you are looking at 500 kV measurement, we already know if that's at 500 kV and the bottom is at zero, the surrounding medium can break down. Okay, so that's where the size becomes, large physical size is necessary here. So you may have still a 10 mega ohm or 100 mega ohm resistor. It's not going to be any more of this size. It will be as tall as a human, 5.5 or 6 feet tall. Okay. So that's very big. Now, as the size increases, of course, with the current and voltage ratings, the large physical size is what introduces lot of measurement challenges. So then we'll talk about a little bit fewer the other time. So you remember that your potential divider you are using is not going to give you any problem, even initiating corona. Because once there is corona, there's current going in that direction. So if you are relying on, see the problem here is we want to measure 500 kV. Maybe let's put even to be realistic, 100 megohm here. So I want to measure 500 kV. I'm going to record here the voltage, which is 400 volts. Now declaring this is 500 kV, the ratio is too big. And that ratio depends on the current that flows here, right? So we're all depending on that one parameter, the current flow. And you need to make sure from your source, the current that flows here is really flowing from top to the bottom, the same current. If you start initiating corona here, then you're taking the current away in that part. So how accurately you reflect that on your measurement will become a question. So the size is important. You have to have the size. And the flashover can occur here, surface flashover, so the dimensions are. So how are these big size instruments or the transducers are going to skip this one? Okay. Cause here, although it looks schematically very simple, Ohm's law here. I'll come back there. So what does it happen? Like, first of all, we are relying on one parameter, which is the ratio of the resistance 1 to resistance 2, right? Which means you have to assure that for the duration of your measurement, that resistance stays the same. It shouldn't change. So temperature coefficient of the materials you are using can impact. Now, if the temperature goes up, your resistance changes. If resistance change, the ratio can change. Then, if this resistance is not 100 megaohm, you may even be able to get away with 10 megaohm, then it draws more current. Okay. So, if it draws more current, you have two problems. The temperature can go up quickly because you have more current. And if you are using these resistive dividers with a DC source, regulated DC source, you have seen their current ratings are 20 milliamps, 30 milliamps, at the most 300 milliamps. So the source may not even supply the sufficient requirement of the current. So if the source is not supplying the current, your measurement is obviously not the right measurement. Right? You think you made a right measurement, the resistor required at least 400 milliamps, but you are only able to supply 30 milliamps, then how can you rely on that? So that loading effect has to be counted, temperature effect has to be counted, and another big challenge here is the presence of unwanted capacitances or the stray capacitance. So because now we brought the size so big, and these resistors are not one single resistor, you can see here there are multiple resistors connected. So if you look at that under the schematic or another resistive divider here, they make it like a helical structure so that the height is not way too high. So internally, each one has a unit like this, and many of them are connected in this, and the tube is filled with good insulating liquid like transformer oil. So that helps you to remove substantially the temperature effect. Now, once you see the structure like this, there is capacitance between this point to the high voltage point. There is capacitance between this end of the disk to the disk part here. There are capacitance even here to the earth here. So we introduce multiple number of capacitances here. We do not sound like a ghost. Right? And if you look at that, a real resistive divider, a big resistance of that structure you saw, is no more a resistor anymore. It is, in fact, a whole chain of resistors and all these capacitors. Okay? So that's the network you have. So now the current coming off of the source you have here passes through the resistor and also the parallel resistance CP and the earth resistance and capacitance and the high voltage capacitance. So there are multiple branches here. So this will explain to you why as a resistive divider you use in 100 EC 100 or first year electric circuit course is not so simple here, much more complex, because your network is much different. So the current that flows here is entering the resistor or the divider is not the current you're taking for the measurement purpose now. You only recorded the current through this last resistor device and the resistance, and you measured the value and used the turn ratio R to R. It's not going to give you as a huge error in the divider ratio calculator. So there are a few things you can apply correction for. They come up with a shielding, and they even can predict or do all the calculation and predict the values or calculate the values here, what this capacitance need to be. And they can play with the potential of the shield so that effect of all the stray capacitance can be nullified or minimized. In doing that, the way your resistance ratio or the current in the main branch where you want the current to flow, or the incoming current into the divider and the outgoing current for the measurement person are very close to each other. Okay? So that most of these high voltage resistors are wire wound resistors. Again, you cannot have an inductance in as a part of these resistors. They are specially wound, so non-inductively wound resistor. There are some resistors they use just the ceramic, so the winding inductance can be minimized. There are resistors that they are also made up of some kind of a for the capacitance, so either the wire type or the ceramic type. I think there may be some film type also the resistors can be. Carbon film also can be used, okay. So that's how the resistors can be used. So again, given the time, this is the one yesterday also Dr. Kishore was mentioning about for the experiments we did, the resistors, they wind the wire in one direction, wind it back to cancel the magnetic field effect. So that kind of tells you about those resistive dividers. Smooth surface is important to eliminate the corona. Cooling is important to eliminate the temperature coefficient. And you take the value of this resistance to the maximum possible value you can go based on the current voltage you are going to measure. Try to minimize the current through the resistor by increasing this resistance so that you can bring down that effect, loading effect. If the loading effect is not there, temperature effect also comes down. And stray capacitance, of course, it is very difficult, but one option is to go for the shielded type of resistive divider, but I'll show you the new technology, but not for this high voltage measurement, relatively smaller one. You can use a fluid-filled resistive type of dividers. They have it in the lab too, deionized water-filled resistor, I think. I saw in your transformer yesterday. In the afternoon, you can see. So that about resistive dividers. I know there may be some, I mean, I just took the whole, you saw, I think, when I, what I was doing, just eliminated the title of my class, 3 hours plus class, I'm trying to push it in 1 hour. Any questions on resistive dividers? It's not shown here, I can't tell. No, shielding is not a shielding resistor. The container will be shielded, metallic shield, and the potential of that metallic container, the container will be varied until you balance all the capacitive, stray capacitances, then you know exactly what the stray capacitance is. Okay. So if you are measuring 400 kV using the same divider, you had to play with what should be the potential of the shield. If you are measuring only 150 kV, then it will change. So that they pre-calculate first. So knowing that, they can keep the container not connected to ground at a different potential so that all these stray capacitances, they can predict the value of that. Therefore, the actual ratio can be calculated. Otherwise, if you take R1 and R2 ratio, it may not be accurate. But then, any other way they can eliminate the stray capacitance? Other than the water field resistors and all that, and this type of conventional shield.
Adding a known capacitor across, which typically you see these stray capacitors are on the order of say 10 to 100 pf. So if you add, let's say 1 nanofarad as a If your divider permits loading, okay, depends on the loading permitted by the divider, you can add a known capacitor chain which grades just as you do the potential distribution.
Then it will become RC.
RC. And in fact, industry now don't call it RC also, they call it CZ dividers because it basically behaves more like a transmission line with a certain characteristic impedance.
Again, where can we use the resistive divider for making DC measurement? Resistive dividers are good for impulse.
There is very little option because
remember, inductive effects are not there. When you are using a other way of reducing is a transformer. When you are using AC, you are having a potential transformer to reduce it. There is no other way other than, and capacitors act as a block, so you cannot get the division, appropriate division. Or once you measure one DC value, it stays remaining there unless you discharge. You have seen that yesterday? We blew up one resistor in the process. Okay, we have learned a lot about that, of course.
Come in here. The question, why there is a capacitor, I mean, we didn't talk about capacitive divider. If capacitive dividers are available, why can't they be used for DC measurement? So the resistive dividers are good for impulse too, but as long as you eliminate most of the stretch capacitor. But definitely resistive dividers are not preferred type of dividers for AC measurement, because we know under AC stretch capacitance are a big thing.
Yeah,
so they try
two things here. Whenever we do a measurement, it should not load. We say loading.
We loading effect, we talked about the temperature effect and the stretch capacitance. So then we can get to capacitive dividers, which are more preferred for AC measurement. These are 2.2 million watt outdoor resistive divider. You can see again, nice and very beautifully structured corona eliminating objects here. So that connecting a resistance to resistance, you can do it, or you can also go for capacitance to capacitance. Okay. So we don't have to use only resistor, any two values, as long as you get your transducer effect done. Okay. So you have a capacitance C1 and capacitance C2. We'll talk about this particular thing, if not today, we'll talk about tomorrow. So now for our argument's sake, we have a capacitive to capacitive divider. So how do they look? Again, you may have a single capacitor if the values are not more than 400 or 500 kV, but if the values exceed, like your big voltages, that may become harder. You had to go for stacked individual capacitances. This is an example of a 1000 kV standard capacitor. When you prepare a capacitance like this, okay, just to go back here, you're using R1 and R2 means R1 is very high value. Now, when you're using a capacitive divider, your C1 is a very small value and C2 is your large capacitance because XC1 is higher than XC2, like this. And again, you can show as long as no other stray effects come into picture, inductance is not playing a role, the voltage to be measured can be get like this. Okay. So that capacitance C1, it's a very small capacitance value, could be in picofarad, maybe few tens of picofarad, compared to C2, which is a large capacitance. But the structure of C1 is harder, because that's the one is going to take up that 500, whatever the big voltage. Okay? So that's where these capacitors have to be designed. Okay? This is a gas-filled capacitance. Best way to devise and design a high voltage capacitor of very small capacitance value, just get the coaxial geometry internal, nice coaxial geometry here.
I'd like to add, in fact, Punekar, my collaborator from
Surat, he developed a air-filled standard capacitor, homemade one, for which, in fact, he did a charge simulation application to calculate the dimensions, and then use that capacitor to already calibrated high voltage AC source as a peak voltmeter. Okay, you have a current potentiometer for peak volt measurement. Using this, we verify the capacitance that's being used. In fact, that was presented in Purdue and later it went to IED Measurement Science and Technology. Just deep thing.
You're working on that?
Not me, there are other 30 of us. Dipti, no, her name is? You? His paper.
So that
is a device how a capacitance C1 looks like. C2 is physically a small capacitor, but capacitance value is very large because the ratio of that 1,000 here you are looking for is between small capacitance to that large capacitor.
These bulk capacitance can look just like your cell phone battery. C2, but even smaller. In fact, microfarad capacitors are used quite often. So I haven't seen them here. We used to use it in Bangalore, that kind of capacitors. So they are also often used in the communication circuits, and therefore they are also called radio capacitors.
You can also see how for a 1000 kV capacitor, that's the height of a person and how big it is. And I saw in your book, that's the one I was reading.
Oh, we came walking into her and looking at this.
Her answer is, Ma, why is this man so short? Okay, so the dimension is really difficult. Again, don't forget that you have to eliminate corona, you have to eliminate any surface potential activity.
Yeah, one other thing which I would like to add.
We saw those corona control electrodes, they're electroids, they're rings or spheroids, ellipsoids, and these are what they call the polycon electrodes, they're called. Poly meaning number of small conducting elements there. The reason is it's easier to maintain the surface that way, one. Two, if there's any dent, it's on one of the surfaces, that can be replaced very easily.
Cost
also is less.
If you want to make a solid electrode of that and that shape,
it's going to be heavy also, because unless you make it solid, it is not going to retain the shape.
And the lightweight, the mask.
In fact, we had one supplier from Kerala who would do this for us. Mm-hmm.
Then, this is for 6 million volt impulse. Capacitive dividers are good for impulse and for AC. And can't use it for DC, and you can find the answer for that. Just because you are using a capacitive divider like this, if one stage like this only filled with the gas in line, almost you eliminated the stray capacitance effect. But if you are going in for a much higher one, a stacked one like this, then you still have the effect coming from those stray capacitances. Either you have to compute them ahead of time and have an idea how much they impact, otherwise for a 6 million volt measurement where your instrument is used, I don't think you can go anywhere more than 1000, I think 1 kV is the maximum the scopes are available. We can make it on a display.
Anybody knows what are the input voltage, that maximum
input voltage you can go for a oscilloscope amplifier?
1 kV. Once you use a normal
electronic. No, normally is plus minus 4 volts. Okay? And there are specialized oscilloscopes used for microwave work and high voltage work which go up to 1 kV. You see there is a lot of this thing, you know. Microwaves and high voltage people have been working together. And now is the time when power electronics and high voltage people have to work together.
There are working, except I don't know in India. In North America it's also very bad, but in Europe they work very well together.
In fact, today I think there is a talk, today or tomorrow, I'll tell you. The person is a power electronics guy, but he has worked extensively on high voltage applications. Right now he is the Minister of Space Technology, but I don't know our schedules and their schedules will clash.
So 6 MV, that's a very high magnitude. So accuracy is important. Sometimes, earlier you were mentioning, if you have a pure resistance to, I didn't put any designation here, you can say high resistive for DC low resistive for lightning impulse and for capacitive part, different types they are given. So as you were telling, like, why not add a capacitance of a significantly larger value so that you can minimize the stray capacitance effect? They know already.
Then do you know?
Yeah, because that was our first slide.
Okay. So
and you don't know? Oh, you better say
he
otherwise.
He has to know. You develop a capacitor.
No, but every one of them, you better say yes, otherwise it's insult for me now.
No, insult. I was
no, to, no, not right.
I was trying to drive home something.
No.
Instead of using a VT there also, we use a CVT.
We don't have to.
Okay.
Well, that's why I'm saying that if they didn't get it into their head, I wasn't teaching them. It's not their fault, it was my fault. Hopefully everybody knows why.
Hey, all of you remember one thing, she is still in jet lag. Okay, it's night time for her.
I'm thinking of my sleep time.
It's
night
time for her now.
So that's all
my
message,
ma'am.
We were fortunate, and our students are fortunate, undergraduates and graduates. We have almost all different types. We have a resistive divider meant for the DC, 300 kV DC. We have a capacitive divider for the 400 kV test transformer. We used to have 800 kV inputs for the space again. We wasn't very cooperative, we had to get rid of this. We only have a second one, which is 600 kV. And we are using kind of an RC here. But it's a pure capacitive divider with a small resistance to damp the oscillations. Meant to be used for a fan delta measurement, but it's in the same way.
I think we can close
this. I think we have to stop here.
Yeah.
Like, too much means you don't understand. We don't retain much of it.
So
but I know nothing new. I thought everything was new. It's just like making your mind to think, wow, that is how it is.
See, if I want to summarize, some of these techniques for measurement using dividers are taught even in an undergraduate second year course. Only thing is they don't put numbers and they don't take to large ratios, which makes a lot of difference. And thirdly, safety is one thing. But all said and done, dividers are through contact measurement, and the trend now is to go in for optical measurements, which basically you're going to have from the high voltage, you don't have a contact. Now you're having a coaxial cable. Instead of coaxial cable, I'll have a fiber optic cable. At the low voltage arm, I'm going to have an electro-optic coupler, and at the other end, optoelectronic coupler. In fact, even the transmission systems, although it's not done fully in our system in India, they are no longer going to have electromagnetic CTs and PTs. It's going to be optical CTs and PTs. Yeah. So, this is the way, and the moment you do that, that's number one. Number two, the data is not going to be in analog domain anymore. It's going to be in digital domain. So, you have to. So DSP is a fundamental subject for whatever science you are doing. Okay, thank you. We'll go to the lab now, and tomorrow we'll continue. What we were looking at is tomorrow we have scheduled field computations.